Remember this problem?
One of the bushings appears to have just like rotted away and fell off on one of my end links.
This is the epitome of a project car because something is always wrong.
Well, that was months ago, and I bought the replacement bushings months ago, but I've just been driving around without a sway bar ever since. So now it's time to finally put this thing back together.
This video is brought to you by ImportSauce.com. They recently did a podcast based on both the blog and video that I did regarding Stage Zero tune-ups. I'll provide a link in the description below, and while you're over at ImportSauce.com, be sure to submit your ride for a feature on their website.
People often ask which end links I use on my rear sway bar, so I actually just use these Energy Suspension end links. I got them from Advanced Auto Parts, and it's basically just this rod and these bushings. I found that these excessively long end links were actually a pretty good fit when running a sway bar with the horizontal tabs on the all-wheel drive rear subframe. Well, would you look at that? Something else is broken. Something else to fix. Assembly of these end links is very straightforward. Put on a washer, put on a bushing, then you'll have the sway bar, another bushing, another washer, a spacer, another washer, another bushing. This is where you'll have the connection to the control arms, another bushing, another washer, and then the nut. You might be wondering why I chose to go with what is an apparently cheap end link option. Well, that's because I'm cheap, and these can be purchased for about $10, $15 at the local auto parts store for something that works just as good as the more expensive options on the market. These are still polyurethane bushings, and I really like the fact that I can source these locally, or if I'm traveling, I should be able to find these at just about any auto parts store. So I was actually thinking that this could be a good opportunity to talk about sway bar options and what I recommend for these cars. I am running the Elevate rear sway bar, which if I remember correctly is a 25 millimeter diameter sway bar. I previously had the IPD sway bar, and I would not recommend IPD's product. It's not that much larger than stock. While it does make a bit of an improvement in handling characteristics, it's not as drastic as a 25 millimeter sway bar or something larger. Now, I don't think you necessarily have to go and buy the Elevate product. The fact is that the Mazda Speed 3, the Focus ST, and the Focus RS all use the same rear suspension geometry, so sway bar options available for those cars will also work with these, and usually you can find a decent aftermarket upgrade option for a lot cheaper than parts that are basically branded specifically for Volvos. I also have the Hotchkiss rear sway bar brackets. Most sway bars come with just a piece of metal that's bent and goes around the bushing. These can flex, and over time it's very common for these to break. The Hotchkiss brackets are these solid pieces of aluminum. They're sturdy, they're expensive, but they do offer nice peace of mind. Driving characteristics with an upgraded sway bar are pretty substantial. Even just driving around town, taking any corner, you'll feel like the back end is just more planted and almost like it wants to kick out or push the car through a corner. I'm not saying that it's going to feel like it's oversteer happy. While you can definitely encourage liftoff oversteer in these cars a lot easier with an upgraded sway bar, but it's just overall is a much more balanced driving experience. If you check out my video about top 10 modifications to do first, the sway bar is high on that list because it is a good improvement. So that's underneath the car, but now let's talk about an upper rear strut bar. While not necessarily a true strut bar, more of a stabilizer bar, we have the Belgian brace, which is a product that is now sold by Elevate. They have a fixed option, they have a removable option. As far as I know, there's no other companies currently offering this type of rear stabilizer bar. I've talked about this bar in some other videos. The idea is that it's basically helping connect this tubular vehicle by just giving it some support in the middle. And I have to say that this bar might have made a bigger handling difference than the rear sway bar did. So this bar is literally nothing more than just a bar that runs between the bolt points for the back rest of the seats. It's a very secure spot. And it's pretty close to the top of the rear strut, so for all intents and purposes, people usually call this a rear strut bar. Now, the bar that I have was something custom that I built. Originally, I had actually one of the Belgian's prototype bars. With the style that I built, you obviously could not have the back seat, but with the bar that Elevate sells, they have flat plates that run to those brackets. So you can actually still have the back seat installed in the car with the bar. That pretty much covers the rear of the car, so now let's go talk about the front. This strut tower bar is the Eurosport Tuning strut tower bar, which is designed to fit all P1 Volvos. I used to have the factory Volvo 1-inch strut tower bar, and I replaced it with this, and I found this bar to be a little bit stiffer. Now, full disclosure, you will probably not notice the improvements of a front strut tower bar when just driving around town and commuting. You really have to be throwing the car hard into a corner before you notice this improvement. And that's largely due to the fact that there's already a brace running along the firewall to help stiffen up the front end of these vehicles. If you can get your hands on the Volvo 1-inch strut tower bar, I actually would recommend it. It's a nice upgrade. While not the best, it's usually pretty cheap. There's also some pretty cool covers that go over the end, which I had on my V50. Now, some later model years of P1 Volvos had a half-inch strut tower bar. That really was nothing more than cosmetic. You could actually grab that bar and flex it by hand. One of the reasons why I like the Eurosport Tuning strut tower bar is because it has brackets that bolt to the strut towers, and then the bar itself bolts separately to those brackets. This is especially useful in the event that you need to access your brake fluid reservoir, or if you needed to remove your battery, or even try to jumpstart a car. Sometimes these strut tower bars can be in the way. Another great thing about the Eurosport tuning bar is it has a relatively flat design, so it should clear most aftermarket intake pipe options. Now, some people will debate that having a bar that's bolted on the end means that it can actually flex a little bit. While that is true, these do have some offset washers that help hold it in place. Overall, I think this is one of the better options on the market because it is removable, and when you do need to remove it, you don't actually have to unbolt it from the strut towers. Now, there are plenty of other strut tower brace options available for these cars, and most of them probably should give you a decent improvement. I just listed off the reasons why I prefer the Eurosport tuning brace compared to some of the other bars that I've tried in the past. One of the other reasons why I really appreciate this bar is because of its symmetrical design. You'll notice that a lot of the aftermarket braces don't actually have a symmetrical design, and that kind of annoys me. Lastly, let's talk about what's going on up front down below. Now, I still run the factory front sway bar. There are a few aftermarket options available for the front. Replacing the front sway bar is a huge, huge,
sometimes they say huge,
pain in the butt. Personally, I think the factory's front sway bar is perfectly sufficient. It does a decent job, and when paired with an upgraded rear sway bar, a good strut tower brace, and that rear stabilizer bar, it makes for a pretty well-balanced car on track, on mountain, in autocross, and just driving around town. I would actually be a bit hesitant about stiffening up the front too much because you might actually encourage understeer. The only other item worth truly mentioning are the end links, and I have tried a lot of different end links over the years. Obviously, the factory end links are a good fit, but they're not that strong, and you may want something a little bit better. If you're lowering your vehicle, you may also want to consider getting adjustable end links. I had the Massive Speed System end links for a while, and those failed within about 5,000 miles. Not because they were a bad product, and honestly, Massive Speed did a great job of honoring their warranty, but the problem was you have so many adjustable points on there, it's just more points for failure. What I'm currently running now are actually OEM equivalent end links for a Honda Pilot SUV. The link itself is massive in comparison to what Volvo offers from the factory, and the ball joints are beefy. It's about the same overall length as the factory end links, and it's got the same general layout where it's a straight bar with one ball joint going this way and one ball joint going that way. Fitment into the factory sway bar was not a problem for me. However, because these ball joints have larger studs, at least on the H&R coilovers, I did have to drill out the bracket bolt hole so that it fit these end links a little bit better. Again, it's largely dependent on the strut or coilover that you're running, but you may actually have a clearance issue with the back of your wheel well and the massive ball joint. So that's something to pay close attention to. But for my ride height with H&R coilovers and the Honda Pilot end links, I don't have any problems. As always, these are just my suggestions based on my experience with these cars and having tried a multitude of different parts over the years, figuring out what works best for my car setup and my driving style. There may be better options out there based on your preferences, but this is what I found works for me. If you like this video, give it a like, don't forget to subscribe, and consider becoming one of my Patreons as a way to help support this channel.